My name is Bill Bonicoy, and I am the Director of Safe Connects, which is the program that is putting this on. I am a co-pastor of Small House Church, the Gathering Christian Fellowship. I'm also a computer programmer by trade. I'm a John Chet of the Life. I've been here since 64. And most important qualification to be doing this talk is I'm a parent. I have three children. And so this is not some big academic issue for me. This is what I need to know. I'm not sure everybody else is wrong. To let you know, we put all that we can into this, because this is not only a workshop for you guys. You guys are not the most important people in the universe. But this is also going to be recorded and eventually put on the web. So if you fall asleep, that would be very boring. And you can feel free to look at the webcast and find out what you missed. We're also looking at making this national model that I hope to roll out for churches all across the country. So y'all are the test guy. I'm going to get blood out today. I hope I have a smile on that afternoon. But that's just to let you know why we put so much effort into this. Because we feel like we're the first folks who really face this issue in the liberty community. And we really want to give the best we can for it. Second mission has our mission to support Christian organizations that use technology to transform vulnerable communities. Technology for many is a key out of some desperate situations. That's been the case for some of us personally. And we hope to help those who are helping us. So we are an organization that comes alongside of the folks who are already doing this. We support folks like the people in this building who use technology to give other people a better life. Safe Connect is a program that has come out of that mission. We have two goals. The first one I'm focusing on now is focusing on protecting children in at-risk communities from pornography and other dangers on the internet. We're doing it in two different ways. We're providing information, yes, ma'am, and we're also distributing software with free internet filtering. And that's awesome now. It's a good fact. We also have concerns about adult issues with this, as I mentioned. That's another part of the Safe Hands program, which we'll talk about later. Final kind of break in the UFOC. The internet. What's so good about it? What can you do on the internet? My lovely sister here is going to help break down whatever you say. So let's get her very busy. What's good about the internet?
Easy access to lots of info.
What can you do like this?
It allows you to communicate with across great distances at lesser amount of pressure cost.
Okay. That's communication, you know, distance doesn't matter. Great. What are you doing then? Oh, come on, no. Research. Good, what else? Okay. Now we're getting real. Let's keep it real. What else?
Games.
Games. What was in there?
Email.
Advertising.
Yeah, advertising. For some of us, it's important.
Read news.
Anything else? Okay, banking, finance. I think we could probably go one. The point is that there's some very useful things about it. Agreed? But there are concerns, and there are dangers, and we're going to talk about next. Let's look at some stats. These are some of the latest stats that we've recently gotten on what's happening online. 90% of kids ages 8 to 16 have looked at pornography, usually not initially, and the average age of first exposure. 11. Think about what it was a generation ago and things like that now. The largest consumer of internet porn is the age 12 to 17 years. Even the adult industry says 23% of the traffic. Minors. Children. Let's look at the industry. The pornography industry is ridiculously aggressive. I'm going to show you three of their tactics that they use. The first is what we call misleading URLs. URL is that www.industry site. That's your URL. So two URLs that are very interesting are picking.com, it's a porn site. So is jessejackson.com. In my humble opinion, that's not what either of you should search for. But that's what they've done. Obviously, that's intentional deception. There's another thing called chat room bots. And you're wondering, what in the world is a chat room bot? Well, this is actually a live transcript from chat room on AOL, American Online. I didn't change anything, I just added a couple of videos. And you notice there's somebody called Bree797. And she's a 20-year-old female with a picture in her profile. And she seems to be kind of stuck on saying it, you notice that? So eventually, CCM1570 said, who is Bree? And now I started on the phone and I said, Bree is a bot. Bree is a computer program that is programmed to go to the chat rooms and randomly put out messages to suggest to people to go look at the profile with a little link to the porn site. Does that make a little bit? Just a little bit? Let's push it a little further. Spam. We all know what spam is. 3.5 billion a day. And the average person gets 4.5. Spam. This is pornographic spam. Not, you know, the person who's in Africa who needs your money. This is just porn. It's hard to see. Don't believe me? Check this out. Vulnerability. How many know about vulnerability? Anybody know what it is? Okay. Very cute little thing, very innocent, very wonderful. Here's the website. This is a good thing. Transposed from you and the eye, and this is what you get. Do you think this was unintentional? Who it is, are you? Here's the next show. Now, I show this because since the time has been cleaned up, and no longer shows, so I don't have any other people. Just want to let you know. This is the kind of thing the porn industry is doing. And they've done it with many, many different URLs that in no case are going to look for. There's a thing called age verification. My daughter, 12-year-old daughter, wants to go to the porn store and ask for a pack of cigarettes. What's going to happen? They're going to ask for ID. If the 15-year-old boy wants to go to the liquor store and get a Suburban, not going to happen. R-rated movie, at least in theory, one hopes that your young teenagers won't be able to get it without an adult. Can you imagine if a little 4-year-old kid could walk up to a cigarette store, a store, and have a cigarette and say, how old are you? And say, okay. But that's what happened, huh? Let me show you, there's sophisticated age verification tools. Here's one. If you're not going to see where's your option, there's no option to do it. So, do you see a 16-year-old boy being stumped by this? I'm 18, and if I'm 18, I'm a Christian senior. I don't know what it's not going to be a problem. Let's see if this one's any better. So here, if you are 18, well, here at least is one that has both options, but we'll just take it. Very effective age verification. Should have worked very well. I'm going to show you some very strong and powerful quotes that I've come across. This is from the Department of Justice. Never before in the history of telecommunication media in the U.S. has so much indecent and obscene material been so easily accessible by so many minds, so many American homes, with so few restrictions. And this one is from Donna Rice, one of our partners. She said that a few mouths of kids can be exposed to material that they never take erased from their mind. The innocence. Remember your name. The young child sees people in the act of sex and doesn't know how to process it. That's a permanent scar. Let me give you some more. From a Kaiser Foundation study, from young people, they said, 59% of them said that seeing pornography encourages sex before kids are ready. This is the young folks saying this. But you want harder, and we got some. This is a study that was just released this month, in Pediatrics and Journal. Youth with exposure to sexuality in a year are twice as likely to have intercourse between the ages of 14 and 16. So pornography is not just a kind of a bad thing. It's having a real impact on what is happening to our young people. I recently had the dubious privilege of attending a debate between folks from Triple S Church, and I'll talk about this in a wonderful ministry. And Ron Jeremy, who is the number one male porn star. Debating the relative merits of pornography. What was both most frightening about being there was the adoration that these college kids had for this monster. And you've got to understand, these college kids are barely 18, if that. They aren't even in college. They're already having the same place that they're coming to the monsters. This is something called child pornography. And you can see these statistics. 20,000 images each week, 20% of all the porn is child porn. 100,000 illegal sites. And $3 billion. There are now websites that are kind of called pseudo-child porn, where they're not showing children how naked, but they're provocative sexy poses and their underwear and other things, and it's illegal. Completely legal. People are paying to see that. It's for anyone, kids. Pornography is not our only problem. Online perpetrators is very serious. I recently saw someone demonstrate this. They were in a chat room, and she pretended to be a 16-year-old woman, 16-year-old boy or teenager. Anybody want to talk to me? And instantly she got hundreds of offers from guys. 1 in 5 kids in the chat room, 20%, has been approached by pedophile. 40% of the abductions in the ages of 15 to 17 from the internet. And you can see that last statistic, how many of those cases involve actual illegal sex. Online predators are now talking to each other, teaching each other how to do it better. They have trading secrets, learning tips, and they've also memorized the language of your kids. So they can seem like a 16-year-old boy when they're really a 50-year-old man. And there are other dangers. One of the concerns is other harmful content. There is some other sexual material, but it's not necessarily pornography, but maybe sex ed or married couples. Or you can find out that it's just, you don't want your kids seeing that. But there's also things like gore. There was a site recently that had soldiers in Iraq posting pictures of mutilated Iraqi soldiers. And they were fully mutilated. It was as disgusting as possible. And this was free. There was no registration. There are hate sites. MLK.com is the porn link, MLK.org, hate site, the white supremacy. And there's less about drugs. How to pass your urine test, where you can get better quality stuff. Things about guns, weapons, armor, all that kind of stuff. We probably don't want our kids there. There's another group of phenomena which show, so I look at them in the chat rooms, instant messaging, and online communities like MySpace or Black Planet. In these, absolutely anything goes. There is nothing to stop, you know, Joe teenager from putting up a dirty picture or calling someone under a name or anything like that. There's nothing to stop it. Letting your kid in the chat room is kind of like letting a teenager run free of all. It's just a very dangerous place to be in this case. And finally, there's this thing called peer-to-peer. File transfer, things like Kava and LimeWire, Napster's and Bitcoin. Three kinds. Illegal, most of the material that is being traded illegal. Indecent, that's the predominant place of child porn is being done. And then infectious. So a great place to get viruses through your computer. So these are places that are really pretty dangerous to your kids to be. I hope that I've had a little concern. Here's the good news. Today we want to get you upset, but we also want to empower you. We want you to come away from here feeling like, well, I know what to do. And I'm not working. We don't want to just give you bad news, we want to give you some new tools. So I'm going to go over these 6 steps in just a second. Starting first with the internet filtering device. Internet filters are just like those that are in the image. They're something that controls what gets there. There are little programs that can say, no, you can't look at this. Yes, you can look at this. And they're very good at protecting kids. They're allowing for adults because adults, of course, don't have control. We have several options. And our first option, you actually have in your hands. We have a program called Peepwalker that we co-branded, and we got an internet available for a low cost of zero. It is free. We want everybody to have access to it. But it is free, and it covers the most basic things. doesn't touch things like DNA, instant messaging, or real-time translation. But it's a pretty good program, and you really have nothing else. It is definitely better than nothing, it does work pretty well. And some people think that's all they have. But you don't think that's all you necessarily want, so we're going to give you some more options, okay? So if you happen to have a great program like AOL or MSN or Berkeley, and you're on dial, that's the thing where you can't talk on the phone with your mind at the same time, then you have an option to get. All those programs have free parental controls. It's free. So does the software. You don't have to buy it. Different levels of each screening. So if you have five people in the family, all different ages, you set them to give each person different issues. Some of the controls can be a little restricted, and it's not quite as effective as some of the other products, but it is free. It's the best thing if you have children and you have a job. I think I might skip it down. American Online is very good at showing you how to do that. I suspect Berkeley and MSN, we can have customer support if you're not sure how to do it. It's not good. But there's a third option. And this is commercial internet filtering. You've got the reason you want to get this. And often it features some other things that the blocker does. Cross-grade, training, looking for it, etc. And some of them have any of these. And then the one more back is you have to put it on each computer. But it's most effective in the projected case. So here's kind of a summary of what we found. We looked on the web and found all of the best surveys that we could find. And we looked at it and sort of averaged it all out, and this is the conclusion we reached. These are the products. And by the way, this is page 8 of your wonderful, wonderful manual. Now, page 8, the same chart is there, so you don't have to worry about copying this down real quick. It's also down on the way. And you'll notice the cost varies from $30 to $70 a year, or $70. Time Manager is a tool that will say, little Johnny cannot be in the computer until 11 o'clock. And not so little Jenny can't be in the computer until 11 o'clock. Now, in case, you can change it and you can adjust it. Macintosh computers are built for Macintosh, and as you see, most products are not. Whether it's built with email, instant messaging, or chat, or peer-to-peer, that's indicated, and keyword blocking again, is so that you can type in certain objectionable phrases as no-dos. And it will say, okay, because you use those words, this website, I can't go there. So you should see some of our websites, because we talk a lot about pornography, we want to block them. That's keywords. And also, I think on our webpage, we have links to where you can buy these products. Still another option is what we call a pre-filtered ISP. An ISP is the company, the organization provides internet service, whether it's American Online, Verizon, or whatever. But there are some that all they provide are filtered websites. You can't even get to the data websites because they don't even bring to your house. They can be very effective, especially using a developer like Lilith. They can sometimes block legitimate content, and that can be a real problem with some false positives. And some of the good protect children, some of the good adults. Let me show you a few of them. These are three of the products that we know about. Particularly the logos that serve the safe side. I see the sludge trying to get into the computer to be locked out. It's kind of cool. The part of the prices are they range, and there's a lot of the products out there. So this could be how you connect to the internet, if you prefer, particularly by dial. That's a gap now. This is a filtering router. You're wondering what in the world is a filtering router? Let's bring a few in here. Thank you. These are pieces of hardware. They're actually boxes. And they effectively filter all the computers in your house. Not just one computer at a time, but if you have 2 or 3 laptops, and Junior has a computer and there's one down there, you know, they're all filtered. And they're really hard to disable. And unfortunately, they're also a little hard to set up. You kind of have to know what you're doing. And they also require that you're logging in. You can't be done with these things. But in summary, these can also be a good option. If you feel like you have a little tech ability, give it a shot and see if it works for you. On our website, we have indications of where you can get these products. So to summarize, Depending on the type of internet service you have, whether you have a native dial, robust dial, or broadband, and depending on who you're protecting, whether you're protecting kids or adults. Your choice. We've got one for you. And I'm going to talk about Spring Watch in the second half of our broadcast. The second is a paid recommended option. And these are the ones that were recommended. Or an advanced one. If you feel like you really have your knowledge to get out of the people ahead of this. So these are some of the options. Okay, let's try this on page 9. So that's it, that filter. But internet filtering is just not enough. This is not something you put in and say, okay, okay. This is unfortunately step 1 of 5. So let me show you a couple more. Where do you put the computer? Now, this is probably the easiest thing I can show you. Put in a high traffic room. Not a sort of obscure corner somewhere. Screen has to be very easily visible in the past 5. Not facing a wall or a little over and kind of hide it. And let me tell you, laptops for children and teens are very high risk. It's kind of the equivalent of a little gun. It's just really dangerous because you just don't know where they're going to take it, what they're going to do. So this is an easy fix. You can do this. Third one is to get what we call a family pledge. And this is basically something that you can download from our website. Feel free to modify it as you need to. It's an agreement between children and parents on how they use the computer. We recommend that you talk to the points with your children and get agreement from them, and then you post it by the computer. And maybe it's not about children and your family. I'm regular because it's something that I need to do and I haven't done it yet, so now I'm ready to say I'm going to do it. Here's what ours looks like. And again, we give you the permission to sort of modify it as you see appropriate. We'll be on things like, I'll look at anything that's inappropriate. Page 6, and then we can pull it out of X-ray vision. I won't give my personal information to anybody. I won't meet anybody in person. I'll be courteous. I won't purchase things without mom and dad's permission. But that I will not respond to emails or messages from somebody I don't know. I'll do what my parents say about when I can use it and what I can do on it, etc. If I'm under 16, they recommend that they not use chat rooms. That's a recommendation. Under 16, you just feel like it's not an appropriate place for children. And only use instant messaging because I know that my parents approve of. I will not install programs without permission. I won't use it to do anything that's illegal, including downloading. And these rules apply whether at home, or at a friend's house, or at the library. And finally, I understand that if I violate these rules, there will be consequences. So these are what we recommend as part of the safety and refresh. Step 4, to monitor training direct children's activity. And this can be a lot of fun. We recommend that you do it once in a while, just sit down with your kids and say, so, what are you doing? Where are you going? What are you up to? Who are you talking to? Who are the folks that you're on the internet? What are you using this for? Not so much in a punitive or suspicious manner, but just as a way to connect. We recommend you do that. And we recommend that you also take that chance to introduce some cool stuff. So those are some positive things you can do. You can also change your homepage. This is something that we recommend. There are what are called child-friendly search engines. You're all familiar with Google and Yahoo. Well, there are equivalents for children. And so what you can do is on your computer, you can have a little gym logs in and it goes on the internet. That's where it starts. We can give you a demonstration how to do that one time. But these are search engines that don't bring up the stuff that you don't want that you're going to find when you type some search words. Unfortunately, we also need to be a little bit more devious. And so we need to monitor our kids' activity by surveillance. That in 3 ways. By reviewing history, by log checking the log filters, and by looking at basic documents. I'm going to go over this a little bit quickly. Here's an internet browser. This is our old State Families webpage. And there's a little button up at the top. It looks like that. It's called History Button. If by any chance you can't find it, press and Control H will do the same thing. So you press that button, it opens up another screen. You'll see some days. Yeah, I'm sorry. It says last week, Monday, Tuesday, and today, I believe, since. I believe it's yesterday or something like that. And if I'm going to click on the today right here, I click on that, that little open button, and that will tell me what websites we're looking at today. And so I kind of go down here, and as I go down, I see, okay, Google, and I see Google, and it's just Google. So that can be trouble. There's all kinds of things on the Google images site. So I open that up, and I just see what they are. Oh, I'm wonderful. They're looking for pictures of rainbow, the state of Minnesota, and not in rainbow. Of course, I should never have been there. So at least this way I can see where they've been. Now, of course, when you finish, you want to press that button again so that your kids won't know you're doing that. So you press the button and this window will go away. Here's the catch. Your kids may already know how to do that. And if they know how to do that, they also know how to erase it. So we have to take it up. If you have a web filter, like VBlocker and some of the others, they keep track of what websites are being looked at as well. They keep a log. And this is what little Johnny or even not so little Jenny can't get to. I noticed there's still a log, and notice here, there's one of those words. And it was concerned, I didn't block it, but it kind of flagged it. This happens to be a Christian marriage website. So that's probably okay, and probably wasn't little Jenny. At least, we hope. But then to go down a little further, that's not good. Most of you probably know whitehouse.com used to be one of the most infamous porn sites. By the way, no longer is. That's why I felt very comfortable looking at it. It's now just a dead. But WeBlogger doesn't know that yet, apparently, so it flagged it as a concern, or at least it's basic intentionality. So you'll notice it had a yes there, meaning we stopped it. Little Johnny didn't even mention, oh, I accidentally looked, but WeBlogger got it. And we'll have a conversation. Finally, we need to check objectionable material that may come from other sources. It can come from friends, email, or spams. It can come from file sharing programs, like COD, LimeWire, BearShare. And also, it can come from portable devices like CDs and DVDs, jump drives, and cameras. And so what you'll do here is go to your regular window menu. I'm sorry, your desktop. See the little start button right here? Press it, and I'll pop the window. And then move our little cursor all the way up and over to recent documents. And that opens another window. And as we look at recent documents, let me make it a little bigger, thank you. We kind of scroll down, and we look at all the documents that we recently opened, and we see, the Word files and the PowerPoint files, and that can't be good. So we can see that recently, somebody looked at a picture file called 9 Nurses. And relax, I just made that name up at this moment. But that's something you would want to check. So you can see, if you saw something that you didn't recognize there, and had a name that kind of, what was the concern? You could find out, and you could actually see what Johnny had been looking at, or trying to look at. And again, have a very interesting conversation. So this is what we call surveillance. This is how you monitor each other. But that's not enough. So step 5 is to educate yourself around issues of online safety. Get smart. One of the easiest ways to do that is to check our website. We have worked very hard to give you the very, very best of online safety information that you could possibly find. So when it comes up, I'm going to show you, we have some pages just for parents. And basically, it's a replication of everything I shared with you tonight. So again, if you forget something or didn't quite get it, it's okay. We got you covered. So here is the our parents' pages. We've got soon will be this. Now, I can't put it on there because I'm not done yet. And the time machine isn't working. But we also have steps for parents. You just saw them. Those 5 steps are on here as well. We've got a sample of the family pledge, which you can download and modify. We've got some of the software tools that we mentioned, particularly VBlocker. We also have recovery resources. And this could be something if you know someone who's struggling with sex addiction or porn addiction or other media addiction. We have lots of tools on how to help that person. We'd love you to try to use those to see if they can use those. This thing is online, so you're free to download it. And finally, the free software that I mentioned. We have the WeWalkers available here for free and some other software. We also have some wonderful resources and some links that I'm going to show you. Every day we get live news feeds of what's happening in these areas. This changes every day.
And so, you want to know what the latest and greatest is? Why not?
So you see all of these headlines coming out. And part of my job in the news is to read and memorize every one of them. So there's news about these coaches.
I was really thrilled to see that they put that family on here.
That's my favorite newsletter. Very excellent newsletter on what's happening.
It's got me current. And even some things about recovery. So that's one thing we have for you. We have articles.
Oh, and we got articles. If you like reading, we got articles.
This one here was an excellent article by Boston Globe
about what's happening with young boys online.
Here's some things for parents that are very useful.
As you can see, there's some wonderful things here.
And let's talk about Gary Aftab,
who's one of the most brilliant people I know in this industry.
And her addition to
addressing issues like MySpace and other things that you may have heard about. She has a whole article about that.
We also have,
I want to read a little bit more books. Lots and lots of books. I'm going to teach you how to visualize.
So I brought three of them. Parents' Guide to Protect Your Children in Cyberspace.
This is written by Gary Aftab, who's a lawyer, who's been very helpful to me in terms of learning things about this. It's an excellent book. If you want more information than I've given you, here you go. If that's not enough, Donna Rice Hughes, who I quoted earlier, has also written a book, Kids Online. It's an excellent read. Again, if you want to learn more about this issue. And here's one that raises a little bit of eyebrows. Smut. And this is basically former person who used to be involved in the sex industry saying, this is going too far. He's got a young child, and he's feeling the same pressure that we feel like. This is not what I want for my child to be raised in. And so he really is pushing for against the PG-13 rated society. Why should little kids see provocative billboards? Why should they see that? Why should they see magazine titles in the supermarket that use words that you don't want to explain to them? Why should that be true? That's what he's asking. And so this is a really challenging book. You can find it, of course, in media.
For those of you who like research, we have links to lots of reports that have been done by different organizations. This is one of them that we call the Third Way. We've got about 6 or 7 of these reports.
These are things that have come before professional committees and stuff like that. So if you really want to scholarly side of it, we got links for that for you.
About something a little easier on the eye, we've got slideshow presentation that you can link to.
And we've got recommendations of videos.
I have to say, this one I've seen, it's a video that was done by a 14-year-old boy.
He produced it, organized it, started it, wrote it, got his principal to play the perpetrator, which is way cool. Used the school as a place where they filmed it, got the police department to volunteer to act in it, and it's just a really brilliant little short that shows how something I thought was going to be a 13-year-old blonde, beautiful girl, almost. What you see? Brilliant.
Really.
So go check it.
And was there anything else I mentioned? We also have, finally, links.
We got one little bit on course. I mentioned NetSmarts, and that's one we put first. That's the one I just showed you with, oh, by the way, WYSIWYG stands for what you see, what you get. Those are the bad guys. That's the word for the bad guys. They have very wonderful things for ages, little to middle school.
This is Rice Hughes' website. This is
Perry Aftab's website. They're excellent for more information.
And last one I want to mention is
GetNetWise. If you don't think we were helpful enough with software selection, go there. They have got dozens of products. So feel free to use that as well. So those are some of the things that we offer on our YouTube website. And the very cool thing is, on your CD is a replication of the website. So if you're not online, you can still look at this stuff. Except if you turn on this, of course, because we don't own those stuff.
But you can feel free to do that. Lastly, continue to use our CD. I just mentioned that. So all the material that I shared with you today
is not only in your manual, not on our website, not only going to be on the webcast, it's also in the CD. So we catch you ongoing and in between. And there's some of the documents here, like I said, that you can feel free to edit. My family pledges a lot of documents that you can feel free to edit.
According to you, and copy freely.
Thank you.
Last step. Lead by example. We're using the phrase secondhand smut. You remember secondhand smoking? Now nobody would think of smoking with a baby in the hand, well, not most people. They wouldn't think of smoking without asking you, is it okay if I smoke? Well, we've done the same thing with sexy media. The children are watching, they're learning from us. Think about how you might have been first exposed to pornography. Lots of the folks that I know, the first chance was they saw the end of the place. It says a message and excites curiosity. Kids are watching. And we don't want to leave them. This is really important that we make sure we're not exposing them to stuff. So we protect your kids from being exposed to these kind of media. They're inappropriate. What radio station do you listen to? What songs they play there? I show you how to find history. Well, there's a good chance your kids know how to find your history. Magazines and books can also be a trigger, and even materials at school, libraries, and friends can be inappropriate. How would you feel if your child, if you didn't want a loaded gun? That would just be so inappropriate. Well, it's the same kind of thing. And also, how would you feel if your neighbor's house had all this material and your kid loved to go over there and play with their friends? So let's, you know, be really aware that we don't want to be responsible for making things harder for our kids. Do us a favor of sending this talk to others. Pass this workshop along to anybody you think could use it. Here's the link. It's also somewhere in the manual. It'll be online in about a week or two. And at this point, we're done.